The Process Podcast, breaking down the daily habits, processes, and tools of high achievers. Now, here's your host, Brad Wilson.
Well, hello there, ladies and gentlemen. This is the host of The Process Podcast, Brad Wilson. If you haven't yet subscribed to the podcast, please do so. It's the easiest and lowest hanging fruit for supporting the show. Speaking of support, if you'd like to support the production of The Process with Brad Wilson in a monetary and tangible way, please check out our Patreon at patreon.com/theprocess or click through our Amazon banner whenever you get the hankering to buy some online goods. On today's show, I have with me Kaitlin Sandeno. Kaitlin is a four-time Olympic medalist, including two bronze, one silver medal, which is her favorite, by the way, and one gold. She's also a five-time world champion. In 2004 in Athens, Greece, Kaitlin, along with Natalie Coughlin, Carly Piper, and Dana Vollmer, broke the 17-year-old world record by more than 2 seconds with their victory in the 4x200-meter freestyle relay. Currently, Kaitlin's a broadcaster and swim coach who's helping to raise the next generation of good people and young swimmers. She's also the national spokesperson for the Jessie Rees Foundation, whose mission is to help every kid fighting cancer to never, ever give up. In our conversation, we talk about working to improve your weaknesses versus staying inside your comfort zone, Kaitlin's favorite Olympic memory, giving back through the Jessie Rees Foundation, helping to raise a future generation of good people now as a coach, and much more. Without any further ado, here's my conversation with Kaitlin Sandeno. Kaitlin, good morning. How are you doing?
I'm great, thank you.
You're very welcome. So I've heard in other interviews that your mom would get more excited when somebody told her that you're a good person rather than you're a good swimmer. So let's start out by defining what your mom quantifies as a good person.
That's a great question. You know, my parents just really raised me well-rounded, I guess you could say. In their eyes, you know, somebody that they're proud of their actions, not just in the pool, but outside of the pool. Good sportsmanship, being a good family member, a good friend, good grades, you know, giving back to the community, somebody, you know, that shines with a bright light. Exactly. Like my mom would get like super emotional when somebody would comment on my character more so than my athletic abilities. That is just something that I try to pass on, you know, doing some coaching and doing some mentoring, that, you know, your athletic career will only last so long, but you as a person is something that's going to be ongoing and something that, you know, will speak volumes for you your entire life.
For sure. Were there any examples of getting corrected for bad sportsmanship?
For me personally?
Yeah, for you.
No, I mean, when I was younger, I was pretty aggressive on the soccer field, but I kept my cool pretty well. You know, I don't think per se I was ever a poor sport. I mean, there's definitely some times when I had some bad swims where I didn't want to talk to anybody, but I think that's kind of the process of being an athlete. Other than that, nothing really comes to mind. I think I was pretty level-headed.
So your parents, this started at a young age, this balance, being a good person with competing?
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, I have a pretty large age difference between my two older sisters. And so, you know, I was going to sporting events, you know, from a very young age, you know, just as the little sister. And, you know, we tried all sports, like everything you could imagine, like my parents put us in it. And then, you know, more than anything, it was like we were just a really strong knit family. And, you know, my parents were strict and disciplined, but I also don't feel like I had to be disciplined that much. I just think I was a pretty good kid. I knew what was right and what was wrong and what was acceptable and what wasn't acceptable. You know, we were raised with good manners. And I think that, you know, my sisters were talented in sports, but not to the degree of like my successes. But more than anything, I mean, we're just I will say proudly, we're great individuals. We're great people. I feel like people really love our family. You know, they have good things to say about us as individuals, not as athletes.
And I think that's the most important thing, that
100%.
We're good people, and that the relationships we build in life are genuine and people love us.
100%.
Speaking of your accomplishments as a swimmer, from the age of 14 to 17, you went from being above average to being at an Olympic level that allowed you to place third, fourth, and sixth at the 2000 Sydney Olympic Games. What do you think was the biggest catalyst for growth in that three-year period?
Wow. Well, growth, specifically physically, I was really small when I was younger, really skinny, pretty short, but like kind of like lengthy, I guess you could say, with like 0% body fat. And then from, you know, the age from 14 to 17, I put on the inches and I put on some muscle. I don't think I really put on a lot of fat either at that time, but I was just really buff at that time. So definitely a growth spurt, you could say. But, you know, that was, I realized my potential in swimming. You know, as we touched on, I did a lot of sports growing up and I was really involved in soccer. And, you know, I did a split my time between soccer and swimming up until the end of the eighth grade. And even when I got to high school, I tried out for the cross country team and I made varsity. And I was like, oh, I don't know. Like, I don't know if I need to do it or should do it. I think maybe I should just go towards swimming. So I declined the cross country program. And then that's when I just, you know, wrapped my head around making swimming my primary sport. And I think, you know, obviously that makes a difference. I went from practicing 2 to 3 times a week to 5 to 6 days a week. And, you know, there's no soccer games to keep me from swim meets. And so all my attention and all my discipline was, you know, solely on swimming. So obviously that made the biggest impact. But I think belief, I guess, you know, I was always, a strong or above average swimmer, as you mentioned. And I just kind of did what I was told and good things happened. But I think it was kind of at that turning point for me where I realized, okay, I think I could be more than above average.
Was there ever a moment when you, it really hit you like, oh my God, like I can do great things with swimming?
Yeah, definitely. You know, it was kind of, it all happened really quickly, but the process of, for making the Pan American Games, you know, it's one of those years where you qualify like the summer before. So I guess I would have been 15. I was like, oh wow, I made the Pan Am Games. And I don't even really know if that really clicked at that point, but I knew it was going to be my first international team, but I had to wait a year. And then when I made the Pan Am Games in 1999, you know, I was one of the youngest swimmers on the team. I was 16 and I went to that meet and I won my two races, the 400 free and the 800 free, and I also set Pan American records. And I think it was right then and there. Actually, I know it was right then and there. I was like, okay, yeah, maybe I am really good. and then it was kind of crazy because the following year was Olympic. So everything happened really quickly. You know, obviously that's not very common, I guess you would say, to be like, oh, I kind of figured it out at 16 and I made the Olympic team at 17. But that was just kind of, you know, for me specifically, that was my walk. That was my career. It was my kind of turning point mentally, winning those two championships and breaking those records and doing that at an international level. I was like, oh, okay, let's do this. And then, you know, after that meet, I had a kind of a heart-to-heart conversation with my coaches and was like, hey, is, you know, the Olympics something you want to train for? Because obviously we know you can do it, but do you want to do this? And we talked about it then and there, but we didn't want to continue talking about it. My coach was kind of like, hey, this isn't going to need to be a reoccurring theme that's always coming up. Like the Olympics, the Olympics, the Olympics, you know, tell your parents if you want, but it's not something that we have to like stress about. And I do want to train for this. But nothing really changed that much. Like, you know, my coaches knew what they were doing. I think I was very oblivious and just kind of was going on their path. And obviously they knew what they were doing, but they needed to get me on board with it. But, you know, maybe the intensity picked up a little bit, but I was already really training pretty darn hard at that point. And for me, the hardest part was morning workouts. I hated morning workouts. Like still to this day, I cringe thinking about them. But that was something that I needed to step up in my training program. And that was something I committed to a little bit more often during the school week.
Well, you mentioned being oblivious at 16. I mm-hmm. shamefully say I can't. I think I was oblivious until I was like 25 or 26 years old. So 16, yeah, I didn't know my head from a hole in the ground.
Right.
Can you tell me about the morning training? What did that process look like? I know it's tough, but
Man, it's early and I'm not a morning person. And so, gosh, we're getting up. I say we, cause bless my dad's heart. He had to be the guy driving me there before I had my license. I think we were like 4:15 or 4:20-ish waking up for a 4:45 practice. And, you know, like, you know, born and raised in Southern California, I don't think people realize, like, our mornings do get cold and we're in an outdoor pool. So, you know, you're stripping down to basically naked. You're in your bathing suit, right? And it's 4:45 outside. The sun's not up. Steam coming off the pool. Your coach is sitting there in a big warm coat. And you're like, oh, my gosh, I'm going to jump in this pool right now, you know? And so I think, like, I mean, I know we're so blessed for where we live. But, no, we do have cold mornings. And it's pretty miserable getting out there at that hour. So I think it was 4:45 to 5:30 to 12, probably about 7. And then some days I'd have to commute a little bit to the training facility, probably about a 20-minute drive. And then the other days I actually trained at my high school. So I would just get ready in the locker room and then go to school for the day. And then, you know, go home, try to get a nap, get another meal and do some homework and then go back to the pool again. So those morning workouts are early. They're brutal. They were like, you know, those were the moments, you know, when people ask, like, oh, did you ever want to give up? It was like every time my alarm went off in the morning, I wanted to give up. I'm like, why am I doing this? This is terrible. And it's still to this day, I'm like not a morning person. And my husband thinks it's so funny because like I'm not the biggest sunshine in the morning. He's like, how are you not used to this? Like you did this your whole life. I was like, I was never used to it. Like it's just not wired that way. But yeah, those are the moments in my swimming career were very, very challenging for me just because I was really unhappy at that hour in the morning.
I don't blame you. And I think there's a difference in not being a morning person and waking up at 4:20 to start training at 4:45. That's like that.
Totally. it's not 7 a.m. You know, it's a lot earlier than that.
Right. You're finishing your training at 7 a.m.
Right. Exactly. When people are getting up.
So you go to the Olympics, you have this very successful career that culminates mm-hmm. in all these medals, all these accomplishments. Do you have a favorite Olympic memory?
Yeah, definitely. My silver medal from 2004 in the 400 IM is the most significant race in my career. And when I think back onto my swimming career, it's the race that stands out the most. You know, I had quite the journey between 2000 and 2004. A lot of ups and downs, a lot of injuries, a specific injury. I had a stress fracture in my intercostal muscles. That was excruciating. It took a very long time to get diagnosed, but to then at that point, once I was diagnosed, to figure out how do I cure this. You know, there was a lot of times in my career during that specific injury that I didn't know if I would swim again or if I wanted to swim again or if the pain was worth it. You know, and then, you know, you go to college my freshman year and this was when it happened. And it was just a hard transition. I wasn't the kid that was like so excited, like, oh, I can't wait to go to college. Like I loved my family. I loved my club team. I loved my community. I wasn't like itching to get out of the house. So even though USC was not far, I wasn't like that kid that's like, oh, I can't wait to leave my parents. Like, I don't want to leave my parents. I have a good thing going right now. So I went to SC and I did enjoy it. Don't get me wrong, but it's a hard transition. I don't know if I was fully academically ready for that transition. And then, you know, the freshman 15, they say I put on like a freshman 20, like just things were different. And then to have that injury on top of it. So it wasn't smooth sailing between the two Olympics. And I was really stuck at, you know, do I want to continue? This injury is terrible. And then after I got over that injury, I was involved in a car accident and but still went to the NCAAs. And once I got to the NCAAs, I had like a fever. And, you know, it was like one thing after another. So the struggle was definitely real at that time. And then when I started getting like, you know, my feet back on the ground and was able to start kind of get over this injury and start training again, I was just stuck at this plateau in the 400 IM of 4 minutes and 40 seconds. Like every time I swam it, I was going like 4 minutes and 40 seconds. So it was just extremely frustrating to be at a plateau for 4 years. And I knew I was stronger. I didn't want to, you know, hit my pivotal at 17 years old. I didn't want to be at the top of my game. You know, there's times where I was like, I told Coach Schubert, at the time I had coach, I was like, I don't even want to swim 400 IM anymore. I'm just so frustrated with it. And he, you know, didn't let me, give that swim up. And at the 2004 Olympic trials, I was just happy to be there just with everything that I had dealt with for those 4 years. I mean, obviously I wanted to make the Olympic team, but it was kind of like a more of like a gratitude just to be there. And then just wanting, you know, to give it my best. And my best ended up, you know, making the Olympic team. But it was funny, when I finished in the 400 IM, I went 440 again. And I was like pissed. Like, I was like upset. And I was like, I've never seen somebody that made the Olympic team so disappointed. And I was like, oh, don't get me wrong, I'm thrilled to be making the team. I'll wrap my head around that in a second, but I can't believe we're going the same time again. So for the 2004 Olympics, all I wanted to do was break 440 in that 400 IM. That was the only thing on my radar, really. Even though I had qualified in three individuals in the relay, I was like, okay, for the 400 IM, I'm going to break 440. And, you know, I saw prelims and went like 440 or like 441. I was like, you got to be joking me. And then for finals, it was like, that was my end all be all. And I just got in the middle of this like race of a lifetime, racing, you know, the defending Olympic champion, the reigning world record holder. She beat me by like 7.5 seconds in 2000. Yana Klitschkova, her and I were like neck and neck the entire like back half of the race, and came down to underneath the flags, got my hand on the wall, looked up on the scoreboard and saw that I had gotten second by 12/100ths of a second. I was like, okay, I'll take a silver. And then I saw my time and I just started freaking out because I had finally gone 434.
Wow.
And it was just a kind of an out of body experience. I would have been happy with 439. I honestly had no idea what I was swimming towards in that race. I just knew I could see her every breath that I took. And to look up and to see that time, like, that for me personally was like my Olympic gold medal. And it was kind of like the first time in my swimming career, you know, I had done some great things in my career. It was the first time in my swimming career that I really just felt extreme amount of pride for myself. Just got out of the pool and I was like, what do I feel right now? And I felt proud. And I just, you know, pretty emotional. I just a ball of giggles, and I just wanted to find my parents and, you know, see Coach Schumer. I'm grateful that, you know, my college coach, who'd gone through so much with me, was on the Olympic team as well. So I got to, you know, embrace on that as well. So yeah, that right there, the 400 IM, the 2004 Olympics, that's my proudest, most memorable moment in my Olympic career.
6 seconds is no joke.
Yeah.
Do you attribute the improvement in that race because you could see the defending world champion, your rival, while you were going? Do you think that she pushed you? Was there anything specifically that made that race special and that performance so special?
You know, I knew what my weakest leg of that race was. You know, it's funny, I started out as a freshman girl. It was like my first cuts and everything. And then at the end of my career, it was the hardest stroke for me to pull together. So I knew my breaststroke was my weak spot, and I took it upon myself to focus on it. You know, I think as human beings, we're so wired to do the things that we're good at. So you never really want to spend a lot of time on your weaknesses. And for me at the training camp, I knew that I needed to spend a good amount of time on my breaststroke. So I took it upon myself. I came to practice early. I stayed to practice late. I worked with all the specialists. I asked like Brendan Hansen, who was like the defending world record, you know, breaststroker, help me. How do I make this breaststroke something that I can rely on and something that, you know, I would always get to the breaststroke and be like, oh man, here we go. And I wanted it to be a stroke, the opposite feeling where I felt strong and confident in it. And that was on me, you know, it's like, I put that on me to take the time and the energy to improve my weakness. And I had the best split in my breaststroke career in the IM that day. But, you know, I don't know, that day, that moment I was on, it came together. Yeah, definitely. Yana pushed me, like seeing her, you know, eyeball to eyeball and feeling her and sensing her next to me. I'm a competitive person. Of course I wanted to beat her. I remember seeing my coaches and the Team USA going ballistic on the side of the pool. So I knew I was onto something good on that freestyle, but I also could feel it. Like, I was an out of body experience. Like, I had never felt so strong in that race before. And that is a killer race. And on that freestyle, I felt like I could have kept going. Like, I felt like I could have done another 100 or another 200. Like, I just didn't feel tired. I just felt so on. So, you know, my coaches hit my taper perfectly. Everything just aligned. I mean, yeah, gold medal would have been the icing on top. But for me personally, I mean, like I said, it was my gold medal. To this day, it's my most beat up medal. It's the most shared medal. It's silver, so it's a little bit more broken down. But it's special to me. So there's a lot of factors definitely that day.
very smart, very clever, strategically working on your weakness, looking at the area that you can improve that will have the most effect on your overall performance versus getting comfortable in your comfort zone and improving where you are already world class, but you can only improve incrementally. I think that's very, very smart technique.
Thank you.
Okay, so moving beyond the Olympics, I want to talk about the Jessie Rees Foundation.
Yes, please.
NIGU.org. Can you tell me about the Jessie Rees Foundation and how you first got involved?
Yeah, definitely. So the Jessie Rees Foundation is inspired by Jessica Joy Rees. She was diagnosed with two inoperable brain tumors when she was 11 years old. And she's a local girl from where I'm from. She was a junior Olympic swimmer at the Michigan Matadors, so very close to home here. And, you know, the swimming community is small. We're tight-knit. And when her story spread, there was some parents that reached out to me asking, you know, is there anything that you could sign and, you know, deliver to her or whatnot and to encourage her. And so I found one of, like, my last national team jackets and signed it to Jessie and sent it her way. And followed her story via Facebook and was just really moved by her. She was so optimistic and so strong. And, you know, she started NIGU, which stands for Never Ever Give Up. And her whole mission was to spread hope, joy, and love to children fighting cancer and to encourage them to never ever give up. Jessie came up with this concept of joy jars. They're 64-ounce containers that are age and gender specific that are meant to brighten a child's day that's going through what she was going through, this, you know, terrible battle with cancer. And she was outpatient and she hand stuffed and hand delivered 3,000 joy jars while she fought. She fought for 10 months and 2 days before she passed away. So when she passed away, I went to her celebration of life. You know, I was just so moved by her and her family. And her father actually led her celebration of life ceremony. And I just couldn't believe the strength that he had. And when I met Jessie and I met her father, I just, you know, I wanted to do more, but didn't know what to do. So we had a very quick encounter, but a very like powerful, very impacting introduction. When she first passed away, her family, they were going to do a hospital visit. And I was invited to go to this hospital visit along with other swimmers like Jason Lezak and Chloe Sutton and some other national team members in the community. And I had never done a hospital visit before and I didn't know what to expect, but I definitely wanted to be there. And I felt honored to continue something that she had started, even if it was just for that day. And when I did it, I just loved it. I felt protected in a sense. I didn't know what I would be like emotionally going from room to room visiting children fighting cancer. But I felt almost like my swimming shaped me for it. I felt like I had like a tough exterior being a competitor, but I have a compassionate heart, you know, from my upbringing. And I just felt like it meshed really well for me and I wanted to do more of them. So one thing led to another that, you know, the Rees family embraced me and asked me, you know, if I would be interested in being the national spokesperson. And at that time, what that meant was going from visit or from hospital to hospital, doing these visits. We were a very, very new foundation, just trying to get our foot in the door, letting families and hospitals know that, you know, we were a community of people that wanted to rally around these courageous children and the brave families and let them know that they weren't in this alone. And to take, you know, my story of never, ever giving up in my own career or journey and trying to encourage them on that level. And then I just kind of took it upon myself at that time to ask other friends that were Olympians or national team members or celebrities if they would use their platform in good and to go visit these kids and brighten these days. And I've done that since May 2012. And over the last 6 years, I've done over 160 hospital visits. Right now with the foundation, I do kind of like spreading awareness through either USA Swimming, getting other Olympians on board. I was just recently a captain for their first fantasy draft. So I was, my team was playing for the Jessie Rees Foundation, trying to spread awareness on that sense. So it's been amazing for me because, you know, as an athlete, you get pulled in a lot of different directions. And it's usually pretty surface. You know, you kind of come to an event and, you know, you wave or you sign autographs, you pose for pictures for an hour or two and you're done. But with the Jessie Rees Foundation, it's really been something that's my community. You know, I have a whole nother family, per se, through this foundation. some really, really close friends through this foundation at its core, and the Rees family are people that are very significant in my life. But it's something that's like kind of like my home base for my platform to give back.
So speaking of the hospital visits,
could you
tell me any stories about the impact that visiting these kids has had on you? And, you know, the more specific story, the better.
Yeah, you know, this has happened numerous times, and to me, it speaks the most because it's exactly what the mission of our foundation is. You know, we were doing hospital visits, and, you know, one specifically was an older boy, which you're like, oh, great, how am I going to connect with a 17-year-old boy right now? And we went to this room, and, you know, he didn't really seem like he wanted visitors, wasn't super engaged when we first came in.
What was his
name?
But,
you know, we just, I can't.
Oh, you can't say that? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, sorry. You know, there's a lot of HIPAA rules.
Right.
But the specific boy, after we started conversing and kind of icebreaker, and the joy jar is a, like an amazing icebreaker because you're basically delivering toys. Like, I get to play like Santa Claus. He started kind of opening up more and started talking a little bit more and even got a couple laughs out of him. And he was really excited to see. I would bring my Olympic medals with me to all these visits, and he was very excited to see them and try them on and took a picture with them and whatnot. And, you know, what I thought was going to be a short visit, because you just never know how long you're going to stay in a room, just kind of read the vibe of the room. We stayed for quite some time, like 15, 20 minutes, and we left, and I felt like happy with how that visit went. And then a nurse came up to me probably about 15 minutes later after we were finishing our visit. She goes, I just wanted to share with you a page that I got. I was like, oh, okay. And she's like, the mom said, you know, if you guys were still here, please, please thank them for coming. I haven't seen my son smile or laugh like that in 4 months.
Wow.
And, you know, like that, like, you know, I hold it together in the room, but of course, like, that makes me emotional on a good level, right? To know what we did really is making a difference. And that has occurred to me specifically probably 4 or 5 different times a year doing these household visits. You know, the feedback that we get from these parents thanking us, like, that's huge. You know what I mean? To see that their child laughed or smiled or wanted visitors, because a lot of these kids say no to visitors. So that specifically are the moments that stick out the most. I mean, there's been so many throughout the years, but that is our goal, you know, to make them forget for a little bit what they're going through, and that we can just hang out and relate and converse and smile and laugh and take selfies and, you know, kind of take them out of this terrible situation that they're in and make it something that they'll remember.
For sure. It's serving others. I watched the videos on the website,
nigu.org,
and, you know, very emotional, very tough.
Yeah.
Very tough for me to watch. And if there's somebody out there listening that hears your story and they want to help in either donating money, their time, what's an actionable step they can take?
Yes. Yeah, so if they go on the website, negu.org, N-E-G-U.org, there's different ways to get involved. You know, obviously we're a nonprofit. So any type of donation, it always does amazing miracles in people's lives. But we also do more tangible things if money isn't something that you could give. For example, we'll do specific drives, like crayons always go into our joy jars. So we'll do like a crayon drive or a sock drive, because, you know, you're cold and you're in the hospital, and they usually give us hospital socks. Well, let's get them some cute, fun, exciting socks. So you can donate socks. If you're local, you can donate your time. You can come stuff these joy jars through our volunteer portion of the website. So there's different ways specifically listed on our website. For schools, you know, we ask for drives as far as coins. Like, maybe you can collect coins and then donate the coins that way. Or a lot of different ways where you can raise the funds through like swimathons, or people that do jogathons, or just different ways to raise money throughout the community. So there's a lot of different ideas on the actual website in order to give back to this amazing foundation.
Awesome. And that's nigu.org. And I'll have the information on my show page as well.
Fabulous.
So that people can find it through there.
Thank you.
So let's go back to, you know, your athletic career ends and you got into coaching.
Yes.
You started coaching other people. Could you tell me about your process for, you know, helping to raise future good people through your coaching?
yeah, definitely.
Paying it back.
I mean, that's kind of my biggest goal. You know, I started coaching at a summer league level because that's how I started my swimming career. 5 years old in the community. We had, you know, a 3.5 month swim team. Let's get kids to like swimming. Maybe they like it so much that they want to join a year-round program. But more than anything, and just kind of disappointed in society as far as our exercise level for children, the weight gain, the obesity, kids glued to their phones or their iPads or, you know, all those electronics. So let's get them out there. Let's get them moving. Let's get them physical for 45 minutes to an hour and a half, depending on their age. I don't have favorites because you're my fastest swimmers. I'm going to have favorites by, you know, what type of person are you? What type of teammate are you? Are you trying? My team motto for my team was great attitude, great effort. Because I really believe that's all I could ask for as a coach. Do you want to be here? Are you acting like you want to be here? Are you trying while you're here? And that was my thing. Like, I didn't care if you're the fastest kid on the team. I didn't care if you're the slowest kid on the team. But if you have the best attitude and you have the best effort, you're my number one. and that too spreads to the parents. I don't need crazy parents. I don't need you to be negative. I don't need you to be in my face. I don't need you to be in your kid's face. You are a parent. Play the role of a parent. Be supportive. Be loving. Be committed. Help us volunteer. This team takes a village. I'm the coach. I'll coach. You're the parent. You parent. I'm not a parent. So I'm not going to parent. and, you know, I believe it starts at the top, and that's what I wanted my assistant coaches to be, just full of smiles, full of positive attitudes. You know, we wanted them to improve their technique as a swimmer. I think there's nothing more exciting than going to a personal best time. I mean, that's my story in the 400 IM. It wasn't about the color of the medal. It's about the massive drop that I've had. So my biggest thing was like, okay, we didn't win a lot of swim meets. We've improved a lot. And I could pull that through the program that we run on how many percentages or best times that we had on the team. Because if we're doing best times, we're improving. We're doing our best. So yeah, it was an attitude thing. It's an effort thing. You know, I didn't allow bullying. I didn't allow rude words. I was really proud specifically of the older kids in my program. You know, in summer league, you tend to lose a lot of your swimmers around the age like 10 to 11. You're usually losing them to year round programs, or for me specifically, water polo. We kind of get the kids start drifting away that way. My older kids, my 13 and up was a smaller program, but they're very tight knit. They're very encouraging. They had a huge bond. Whenever we'd have a new swimmer, they were very welcoming and including them. And to me, that made me very proud, just because I think that age, you know, 13 to 18, you start seeing the attitudes, you start seeing the clicks, you start seeing the negativity. And, my team didn't have that. And I was really proud of that. And I think, because they are that age, that's what the younger kids look up to, and that's what they see, and that's what I expect. You know, we're not a team full of cliques. Obviously, some of these kids go to school together, so that they're closer with one another, and I had 220 kids on this program, so obviously some kids are going to get along better than others, but we're a team. We're the Lake Forest Two Dolphins. We're a community program, and I was proud of what I built over there for the last 4 years.
And like you said, these things happen from the top down, so it's it's commendable that, you know, that's the culture that started with you and spread through them. So definitely something to be proud of.
Thank you. Yeah, I really am.
When you're coaching these kids, what's a common barrier that you see that stops them from being the best that they can be? And it doesn't have to be, you know, it could be outside forces or inside forces. And what specific steps can they take to overcome that barrier?
I think on the parent side, your number one priority is to show your child unconditional love. Your child has to feel the same love when they get first place and when they get DQ'd. Because for me, I knew no matter what, I knew I was loved, and that made me not afraid to fail. So as a parent that has kids in the sport, your number one priority is to show your child unconditional love no matter what place they get. your kid has to know it is okay to get first and it is okay to get last as long as you tried your absolute best. The love that they get from their parent is not determined on a place or a record or, you know, a gold star, I guess, you know?
Right.
And it's support. Like, I felt 100% supported. And that meant that I reached for the stars and beyond, because I knew I wasn't going to be loved any less if I didn't get those stars.
I love that you mentioned not being afraid to fail, because that fear of failure in a lot of ways stops growth.
Oh, 100%. Yeah.
You don't allow your children to be all that they can be because they're afraid of failing. And a lot of times whenever you do get better and improve, it comes from experimentation and learning, trying new things enable you to grow. So you may take one step back and then two steps forward versus always staying in the same place.
Yeah, definitely. And that's a big thing when people are like, well, why do you think you're so good? I was like, 'cause I was never afraid to fail. And I was never afraid to fail because I always felt unconditional love. And you know, that comes from your parents. Obviously I believe I had a God given talent for the pool or athletics. I think I'm an athletic person. I was born that way. I think I had a born fire. That's also something I see as a coach. You either have that or you don't. And that's really hard to teach. There's some kids you can just see it in them. And I think I had it. But you know, if my parents didn't raise me the way they did, I wouldn't have seen that success either. I think as a coach, specifically for swimming, I think swimming's hard and kids don't like hard work.
You know, adults soccer, don't like hard work.
Right. Yeah, totally. That's true. We don't like to be uncomfortable, like we talked about earlier. And specifically in swimming, pretty much from the moment you get in, it's hard. You know, in soccer, you're doing drills. Those aren't necessarily hard. It's like more focus, if you know what I mean. And you take some breaks and you're walking or whatever. Like, so you're constantly going. Yeah, we'll do technique and we'll do drills. But like, you're holding your breath while you're doing these drills. So that's hard, right? And so, especially the level that I coach, because it is summer league, but it is very beginner level for a lot of people. Yeah, it's hard. Butterfly's hard. You know what I mean? So what kids are okay with pushing past being uncomfortable? So that's kind of the biggest barrier that I see in my sport specifically and where I'm coaching. Kids don't like to push themselves. But like you said, adults don't either. So I think that's the biggest barrier. And I already said this, I lose a lot of kids to water polo. Water polo is fun. You know, they like that aggressive side, the competitive side, the team side, heads not down in the water as much. So for my barriers as a coach that I see, keeping kids in swimming is hard to keep them against water polo. And swimming's hard.
How do you push them when it's hard and ensure that they keep going and they do realize their potential?
You know, I just try to encourage them. I don't really like to yell, but like I do, like, you know, I cheer a lot. I'm like their number one cheerleader. You know, our swim meets, there are long, long days and I cheer for every single kid on my team. I have 220 kids and I'm exhausted afterwards. But it's like, I loved hearing my coach cheer for me. Like I loved hearing the "Let's go, Kaitlin." So, you know, you better believe that I'm saying that before every single one of my kids. So, you know, I think I'm their biggest cheerleader and that's how I try to encourage. And I would do that in practice too. I wasn't necessarily quiet on the pool deck. But I also hope that I built a bond that they would want to do well for themselves, but for me, you know, because I do praise them a lot and I would try to speak to each kid every single day, because swimming is so many kids in a group, you know, you could feel lost or feel like a number. So I try to relate or even just say good morning or thank you for coming or keep it up or let's go, like any type of feedback. So they know that they are noticed, because I think we like to be noticed.
Yeah, the personal relationship 100% matters. Speaking of all the good things, let's go to the other side. What's a common coaching practices that you see or hear about that you just completely disagree with?
I mean, favoritism, obviously. But I think that's a hard thing to break. You know, I'd be lying if I said I didn't have my favorites, but my favorites were more the kids that had that contagious positiveness to them, or my team leaders, And those weren't necessarily because they were fast. I mean, I didn't have a team of superstars, but I had teams of strong individuals that were confident in themselves, you know, and the negative talk, obviously. I think it is hard as a coach because it does get very frustrating because you would see potential in kids and they don't see their own potential, but like you can't force them to swim fast. They have to swim fast. So, you know, it's, I try not to have too many of the negative yelling, but you know, there are some days where I'd have to just pull them all out. Like, guys, sit down with me. We need to talk. You know, and it's like, I can't do it for them. Like, I already did it. You know what I mean? Like, I already had my time to shine. And I don't also need to teach myself freestyle. Like, I'm not just talking to hear myself talk. I feel like not all the kids may have realized how well versed I was for this job. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And how I wanted to give back to the sport. I know my stuff. You know what I mean? And to be coaching at that level, not a lot of kids would have that opportunity to get a coach of my caliber or with my credentials. Giving back in that way, so don't take it for granted. You know what I mean? But have you ever watched Last Chance U on Netflix?
No, I haven't.
Documentary.
I haven't.
You know, this coach that I watched this past season, he got great results, but he also had a mouth of a sailor. But also, you know, he's coaching at the college level, and I'm coaching at the youth level. But I just don't think that's necessarily the way to connect with people either.
In my an interview that I did, two people, Adam Creek and Bob Babinski. Adam's an Olympic champion rower. And one of his coaches, when they were rowing, told him to imagine the other team when they were trying to go harder and imagine that the other team's boat had capsized. And when they were coming out of the water, imagine pushing them back down. Like, and a lot of friction as a coach, definitely a different coaching style. And I think that had some long-term ramifications on people afterwards being like, you know, it didn't really resonate with people in a super positive way. So I think it's interesting to hear about the different coaching methodologies.
Sure. Oh, definitely. There's so many. But I also think we all have different groups of kids, too.
For sure. And the type of people respond differently to different things. And obviously, he's coaching Olympic-level rowers, these giant men, and then coaching, you know, 9-8-year-old girls. Yes. Little girls is a little different.
100%. 100%. It's too funny.
What's a current large goal that you're working towards?
Oh, wow. You know, for me personally, I've been getting a lot of opportunities on the other side of the sport with a microphone in my hand. So I've been really enjoying the hosting roles. USA Swimming has been branching out and been trying to do different web series. You know, because of our years past, we've done a lot online. So the swimming community is used to that, like finding either the swim meets online or the different kind of like pre-meet stuff. For the last Olympics, the 2016 Olympics, they started a new show called Deck Pass Live. And it kind of had a college game day feel to it. What's going on? What do we have to look forward to? Who's competing today? Who did what last night? Who's the big rivals? Et cetera, special guest. And I had the honor of hosting it for the first time ever 2 years ago for the Olympic Trials. And then this year they did a new show called Paper Time. And it was myself and Olympic legend Jason Lezak. And we did a really fun show concept before the start of finals every night. So I've given these opportunities and I just really enjoy it. I really love being able to pull the athlete's personality, get to know them more outside of the pool, kind of like what we were talking about earlier today. I mean, it's great to be a great swimmer, but what are these swimmers like and how are they relatable? And what, you know, once you get to know these athletes more, I feel like you cheer for them even more because you're like, oh, wow, like, they love cats. I love cats. Like, we bond. You know what I mean? Or, oh my gosh, she's so cute about the relationship she has with her mom. Like, that's the relationship I have with my mom. And, or I'm from that neck of woods. Like, let's get to know these athletes outside of the pool. And I really enjoy being that person that gets to bring their personalities out. So like my ultimate goal is, you know, not that far away. I would love to be involved with the 2020 Olympics in Tokyo, you know, whether that's with NBC or the Olympic Channel or whatnot. I would love to have that role because I feel like I can relate to these swimmers and athletes in general, having been there. You know, I don't have any formal training with the, you know, the communication side of things of being a host or being an anchor. But every time I get that opportunity, I think I grow and my reel gets better. And just working with different producers and with different networks, I feel like I have the ability to do that. So that's kind of the goal that I'm working on right now. I would love to have that opportunity at the next Olympics.
Awesome. I love that. I love the humanizing process of getting to know people and
yeah,
you know, being, you know, more than an Olympic athlete, more than, you know, what you're doing, like who they are. Mm-hmm. That's one mm-hmm. of the things I love most about this podcast, talking
I'm
to
sure,
people and
yeah.
getting to learn about them. And I did read that you were not exactly a fan of social media, which we're around the same age and I'm right there with you. Like, I don't know yeah. why I face this internal resistance with like Twitter and Instagram and Facebook.
It's a lot. I feel like I'm improving because I know I need to, because this is of my specific goals that, you know, we just talked on. And it's unfortunately, that's like the world we live in right now. But I go through phases. Like right now, like I'm just not on it. Like
You improve not because you, yeah, not because you want to, but feel like you have to. And that's like,
yeah.
So I do Twitter, Instagram, Pinterest, Facebook, LinkedIn. What am I doing with my life? Like, I don't have time to eat. Like,
and I like to eat.
Right. And then, you know,
then
I interview my guests for my podcast and I write blogs and I do these research, you know, a lot of the people I interview are authors. So I read their books and then I'm looking at their interviews and I'm like, how? And, you know, it's a passion project. So, you know, the sustainability of it is a long time in the future. And you're like, wow, like I'm putting in like 50, 60 hours a week here.
Yes.
It's easy to get overwhelmed.
So, yeah. And I've gotten to the point though, and I've appreciated this good feedback, is I only do if it seems like I don't try to force it. It's like it's all organic. And I've gotten some great feedback like, oh, your social media seems like so much better. Like it just seems real and it doesn't seem contrived. And that's like, yeah, like I might be like on Instagram for like 6 days straight, but then I might go off of it for 6 days straight. And that's kind of where I'm at right now. You know, I don't want to post just to post. I want to post to like build my brand, you know, a little bit. And like we talked about, like getting to know, you know, the athlete or the person or who I am or whatnot. Sure. But like, I don't want to be like down your throat or like, oh, look at like, I don't want like a highlight reel. Like life gets messy sometimes too. You know what I mean? But it's like, you know, I'm not going to put on there, but I'm actually in the midst of, this is kind of funny. My husband is like totally not into social media, like whatsoever, but he's
good
in
man.
An industry where, but he's in an industry that would really serve him right to get more involved. For me personally, he's my health and wellness guru. And for him to grow his business, it would really kind of do him right to get out there. So right now, my passion project is teaching Pete how to use Instagram and what hashtags are allowed. And like, he's so funny and like how a filter works. So right now, he's my passion project for the social media, but it's almost like the other night we posted something, he kept checking it. Like, all right, baby, you need to put it down now. We're done. Okay. Like, let's have less time.
That's how it goes. Like,
so funny.
Yeah. Pete, just, you know, if you don't want to do it, don't do it, man. Hire out somebody to manage it. I deleted Instagram because I did Tailwind. I set up all my stuff and then I found myself checking it and like learning about how to grow your audience. And it's like, you got to follow people so they follow you back and comment so that they comment you back. And
how
I'm like,
this
is the worst thing I've ever done. It's like a video game. And like, I just deleted it. And I update my status message for like the new interviews that I post, but I haven't posted anything because my podcast One of the things that inspires me and a big goal that I'm working to is I want to inspire a million people to live a life that's authentic to them. And I just, how can I have that goal and not live it myself and do,
sure.
you know, be involved in the social media thing? Oh, I don't know.
Right.
Yeah.
If you like my post, I'll like your post. Like that sounds very, very authentic.
Yeah. Keep it up with the little hand symbol and a thumbs up. It's like, oh God.
Right.
I hate this.
And then like when we're talking about like the youth and stuff, I'm like, it is so sad that we're being validated by likes on the picture. You know, like when kids are talking about, well, they have so many followers. It's like, really? Is that how we're judging our self-worth right now? Like, I can't get down with that. You know, there's so much more. There's just so much more to life.
And there's automated programs too that send messages. Like, so you follow somebody, then you send them a message. So somebody followed me and they asked me about being a guest on the podcast. And I felt this like inner conflict about it. I was like, God, do I not? And I basically put it off 6 months into the future. I was like, maybe in six months we will. We'll circle back, you know?
And then, back
yeah. So then they send me a message and they're like, oh, that's just an automated message that I send to everybody. Oh, and I'm like, man, man.
You're like, no, you shouldn't have told me that.
Yeah. Like we're circling back now. No, it's a no go.
Oh my gosh. That's crazy.
Anyway.
Times
okay.
Times have changed.
And they're never going to be how they were before, which is
to me,
unfortunate.
I know.
So, okay, are there any books that you reread every few years? And if so, which ones?
I mean, no. Short answer, no.
Okay.
You know, I pick up my Bible and tend to read the same things over again. But to be completely honest, my dad is a reading fiend, and I did not get his gene. I pick up books, I start them. I gotta say, I don't always finish them. I do have self-diagnosed ADD. I have a hard time sitting still for too long. But no, I do not have a go-to reading read. But I'm actually in a book that I love right now called Love Does. And I'm just like loving every minute of it. I end up somebody to refer a book to me because if I go to the bookstore, I get so overwhelmed that I'm like, I just walk out there empty-handed.
Right. Hey, knows an answer. You know, you don't have to.
There you go.
don't have to. So, do you have any projects that you're working on that are near and dear to your heart? Passion projects.
Yes, but unfortunately, I can't say it right now because it's in the works and we haven't released it, and we're doing a really big build up for it. But I'm really, really, really excited, and it's something that I've wanted to do for a very, very long time. So hopefully I can tell you about it. Well, I will be able to tell you in the near future, but unfortunately I can't say it today.
Yeah. Just tell me about it later. And,
yes, definitely. The suspense will keep you on your toes. I'm sure.
For sure. So have you ever strongly believed something only to reverse course later on? And if so, what led to that change of belief?
Yeah, this is like, I mean, kind of fluff, and I probably won't have like very specific. But before I met my husband, I felt like I had a good grasp of nutrition and like health. Like I was a professional athlete. Like I know my stuff. Like I know what to eat and what not to eat. And once I met my husband who, you know, has his master's in nutrition, like my whole like knowledge in the health world just got completely rocked. Like everything that I thought was healthy wasn't healthy. And the things that I was looking for, like on the back of, you know, the nutrition level was just like, oh, and like how often to eat, when not to eat, when to eat before bed, like all of these things. And it was just like, I personally felt a night and day difference, with my own body, with my own health. I had like a reoccurring terrible stomach issue that was, oh my gosh, I can't even tell you how bad it was. And for the longest time at the time, he was my boyfriend. He's like, you know, I think it's this and this. And it's all about the way I was eating. I was like, no, there's no way. Like I eat well and blah, blah, blah. And sure enough, I switched to his way. And this like debilitating pain, I was in the emergency room, I was in the hospital for days. Nobody knew what was wrong with me. It was cured just like that. Just with things that I was eating that was wrong in my diet. And my physique has changed so much. My energy levels have changed so much. I feel probably stronger now than I did then, more in shape now at 35 than I did when I was like 25, all because of what I had thought was healthy. really wasn't. And so, you know, I will say I was very kind of stubborn on it because I really did think I knew what I was talking about. And I was like, yo, what is this peak I know? And then sure enough, he's totally changed my world on the health and wellness side of things.
That's not fluff to me. That's fascinating. An Olympic level athlete, like,
yeah,
how is there this disconnect? Because I know you have nutritionists and stuff with the Olympics, right? That are coaching you and helping you. How is there this disconnect between what's actually healthy and what's perceived to be healthy?
I think you have to remember too, like for my heyday, I mean, that was a while ago, like 2000, 2004, like we are so advanced and things have changed so much. And, you know, when I was in high school, nutrition wasn't like my first Olympics being 17. Like, I mean, my body was probably perfect at that time. You know, I didn't have a lot of fat. You know, I had home cooked meals, and I mean, not to say my parents definitely were old school cookie mentality. We didn't eat healthy, but my physique was on spot. And then, you know, when I went to college, I mean, I put on a lot of weight. Was not eating healthy. I mean, gosh, Krispy Kreme donuts. I used to like treat myself to like after every morning workout after like Mondays because I'm like, okay, this will get me through the week. You know, Jamba Juice was downstairs. I'm like, oh, it's Jamba Juice. It's got to be healthy. Oh my gosh, no. You know, and I was so hungry all the time when I was training. So it was like, what was fast? What was easy? Like, I was a terrible cook back then. Yeah, I really believe like it was kind of like what's fast, what's easy, you know? And then when I was a pro and living in Michigan, I was on the all guys team for a while and we would go out to breakfast afterwards and just hammer like pancakes. And at that time, like I didn't really think it mattered. Like I just felt like I needed the calories. I was so hungry. So I wasn't like choosing. And like, it's crazy. Like if I compare my body now compared to then, I'm like, I am so much more in shape now than I was then just on the fact alone of what I was eating. Obviously I trained 1,000 times more than I do now, but I feel really good right now. Like I feel really strong and I really, I have my husband to thank with that, with his, you know, his background in his nutrition. And unfortunately I just didn't really have that back then.
Awesome. That's a really, a nice blessing that he helped you with that. And sometimes I forget that I'm getting older. I forget that 2004 was like 14 years ago.
I know. Tell people, you're not allowed to tell people that.
I was telling my wife a few weeks ago, I interviewed Scott Myers who sold a screenplay in 1986, I think.
Wow.
And to Universal Pictures. And, you know, I was writing, you know, doing his intro, typing it up. And it's like, he's been a professional screenplay writer since 1986. So I'm like, that's 32 years. And then I just stopped and I looked at my wife and I was like, I was alive. He's had a 32-year career and I was alive before his career started. Like,
so funny.
What
I know,
has happened?
Time flies.
It really does. So if you could share one truth with the world, what would that truth be?
About myself?
No, if you could help them realize one truth about the world.
Okay.
Humanity.
You know, I really, really believe that there's always a silver lining. You know, it's just, I've gone through some things. My family's gone through something. You know, my mom was recently diagnosed with breast cancer 3 years, almost 3 years. Was that? Yeah, 3 years ago. And, you know, my world crumbled. Like I had never been, I don't think I've ever cried so hard in my life. And then just with, you know, the background that I've had with the Jessie Rees Foundation, I was just like, I couldn't believe that this was happening to us. And, you know, through it all, there just continued to be a silver lining. And I would not wish that journey upon anybody. I'm so happy to say that my mom is strong and healthy and beat cancer. But, awesome. You know, it made our family stronger, which I never thought could even be possible. I didn't think we could get closer. I didn't think I could have a stronger bond with my mom, with my dad, with my sisters, and we did. And she continued to get blessings with her diagnosis as well. And, you know, I just, in the darkest time, I do believe that there's always a silver lining that you can find. And it's just, you know, if you're remaining grateful, remaining humbled, and just knowing that it will always get better. There will always be something to be grateful for.
I'm very glad to hear that your mom recovered
and
beat cancer.
Oh my gosh. Thank you.
And Viktor Frankl in Man's Search for Meaning talks about, he went through the Holocaust and wrote a book about his experience and this, that suffering can lead to transcendence. And I really think it's a strong testament to your family and how close-knit they are, that the suffering that your mom went through made everybody closer. And keeping that positive perspective, I think, can make or break us in our human experience. All right. So final question.
Okay.
Where can my audience find you on the interwebs?
On Instagram. Just kidding. Oh my God, that's funny. You know, well, yes, I am on all social media, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, Kaitlin Sandeno. And then I have, my website is kaitlinsandeno.com. And yeah, that's me.
And don't expect much engagement on any of the social media platforms.
I'm getting better. I'm telling you, I do like to try to connect.
I don't know if it's good. Yeah, I don't know if it's a good thing to get better or not. Like, I think
it's not that froggy, right?
Yeah, when you have this sick feeling in your stomach when you need to do something or feel like you need to, then maybe you just shouldn't do that thing, you know?
That's so funny.
All right. Thank you. It's a pleasure and an honor having this conversation.
Thank you.
Yeah, we'll talk soon.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful rest of your day.
Pleasure.